Anyway, I was talking about Jonathan Alter. He's also an MSNBC analyst and former senior editor at Newsweek. He's the author of three New York Times bestsellers. Two of them are on Barack Obama, and one of them is on FDR. And today, the takeoff for our discussion of Jimmy Carter and human rights will be emerging out of Jonathan Alter's latest book, which is the definitive magisterial biography of Jimmy Carter, called His Very Best, Jimmy Carter, A Life. Yes, it's almost 800 pages, and yes, I have read it.
That's
and
with
yes,
notes, Joe.
I shouldn't, yes.
It's a lot less without the notes.
Without the notes, it's much less, right? And yes, it's a marvelous book, very readable, that deals with Jimmy Carter, his virtues and his flaws. It's not a hagiography, and it's really a book that I think will resonate into the future as the standard biography of Jimmy Carter. We're not going to be talking about Jimmy Carter's swath of his 96-year career. Jimmy Carter is 96 years old, right?
Perhaps. 99 now.
99, excuse
yeah,
me.
Yeah.
Perhaps, excuse me, I didn't want to sell him short. Perhaps in his last months, but he's always fortunately lived longer than we expected he would. And we'll be talking not about the swath of his long career, but focusing almost exclusively on his contributions to human rights. Okay, so without further ado, let's extend a very warm welcome to Jonathan Alter. Okay, have a seat. Okay, as I said, we'll be talking almost
thank you for coming.
Exclusively. What?
I just want to say thank you to everybody for coming, and thank you, Joe, for doing this.
No, this is really for me. This is really a thrill. By the way, I should mention I'm a retired professor of human rights. I taught human rights in the graduate school at Columbia University for 20 years and at Hunter College and for the United Nations. So this topic is very close to my heart and to my activism and my intellectual and academic commitments as well. Let me start, before we get to human rights, I have one question. Of course, you've gotten to know Jimmy Carter personally through writing the book and perhaps otherwise. Tell us about Jimmy Carter, the man. What type of guy is he? What are his virtues? What are his flaws? What is his temperament? What is your impression of Jimmy Carter as a human being?
Well, I think the first thing that needs to be said about him is that he's an eminently decent man.
Mm-hmm.
And everything about him grows out of his core decency and his belief that he needs to live his faith. He's a very religious person. He's a liberal Baptist, but in some ways, I think his thinking on life resembles more that of a Methodist, and his wife, Rosalind, was raised as a Methodist, though they now worship in a Baptist church. And the Methodists believe you do as much as you can for as many as you can for as long as you can. And that's kind of how they've led their lives. But it's important to understand that Carter, the first half of his life, until he was 50, or 48, he didn't stand up. So he wasn't a racist because of the way he was raised. His father was a white supremacist. His mother was a nurse who took care of black patients for free. And he was raised in large part by an illiterate black sharecropper. But he ducked the civil rights movement on his way up in business and politics. And then he spent the second half of his life making up for what he didn't do in the first half of his life. And this sense of atonement is really important, even though he, in our many conversations, he would only tiptoe up to it. He wasn't quite willing to say that he had led a life of atonement. But I think any honest assessment of it would suggest that he did. In terms of his temperament, I think Zbigniew Brzezinski, who was his national security advisor, put it pretty well. He had, still has, essentially three different smiles. He has the big public political smile that was, in some cases, a little bit artificial, that he was, that would be in all the cartoons and everything. And then he had a tight, closed mouth smile where he would drill his icy blue eyes into you and the temperature in the room would drop. And I experienced that on a few occasions. He could be very prickly and and difficult, not raising his voice, but just chilly. Mm-hmm. And then he had a third sort of authentic smile when either he or somebody else would get off a funny remark. But it's important to understand that he, you know, he's not a saint. I think people view him that way. And he's also not humble, because there's no such thing as a humble politician. You don't get very far if you are. But he is a man of modest personal traits, and he believed that he should use both his presidency and his post-presidency not to just advance his own self-interest, but to do things, a lot of things, for others. And I think that, you know, his political failures obscured the fact that he is a man of very substantial accomplishments.
He was. I sort of see a motif of your book is trying to rescue Jimmy Carter from the presumption that many people have repeated over and over again, that he was a far better ex-president than he was a president. And part of your book, I think, is to try to unearth his accomplishments, which were rather formidable, but have gone not sufficiently recognized.
Right. And that's kind of the lazy shorthand. If you went out on the street, you know, anybody you talked to, literally anybody you talked to, would say, oh, Jimmy Carter, yeah, not a mediocre president, great ex-president. The problem is that when you're a former president, you don't really have any power. So he's done great things on curing Guinea worm disease, nearly eradicating a disease that afflicted millions of people. And he has helped champion Habitat for Humanity, although he's never run that organization. He was chair of the board at a certain point, basically spent a week a year building homes. I built one with him in Memphis in 2016. And he, you know, has promoted democracy as a former president and monitored elections. But significant accomplishments, and he revolutionized the post-presidency, changed it and the expectations of it for all of his successors, you know, by not just playing golf and being on corporate boards. But whatever his achievements are as a former president, they're a little bit overrated, and the achievements of his presidency are underrated. And I think he's very much of a misunderstood figure, and that's largely because he was crushed when he ran for re-election against Ronald Reagan.
Yeah, we'll talk about those achievements, but just a little bit more on Jimmy Carter, the person. When you talk about his icy smile, what comes to mind is this photograph. Oops, I think, oh no, here it is, that you included in here, and I think you probably were deliberately trying to make a point. Let me show you here.
I talked to him about it as well, and I talked to a couple of the other presidents about it. Yeah.
It wasn't just an active dislike of other presidents, other operatives in the Democratic,
especially Democratic presidents. Yeah, exactly. So I talked to both Carter and three of the four other presidents there, and that was and I can't tell you which ones said what, because on that particular subject, I was talking to the other presidents on background, although I was talking to Carter on the record about it. So that was when Obama was president-elect. And they got together. Bush Jr. was still president. And they got together. And, you know, it's a very small club. And the others kind of wanted to talk about, well, how's the food? You know, Barack, the food here is pretty good, and you can get, you know, a good steak anytime you want it, you know, and the other kinds of things that are involved in being president, and a kind of a cheery, informal you know, camaraderie almost. And Carter was there to sort of pursue his agenda and make sure that Obama understood, you know, that he had to do certain things. And Clinton in particular, he had had a very difficult relationship with, and that we could talk all night about their fraught relationship. Although what was fascinating was that in the summer of 2021, it was their 75th. It was 2021. My wife and I were invited to their 75th wedding anniversary in Plains. And it was mostly local people. I didn't have one of these big splashy parties, but Nancy Pelosi came. And to everybody in the Carter family's amazement, Bill and Hillary came also. But basically, Bill Clinton just really resented Carter saying, you know, you need to do this, you must do this. And in some cases, it could be very helpful. Like he told George W. Bush, do something about Sudan, and he did. But he had been very supportive of Barack Obama, and then he felt kind of ignored by him. And I asked him the first time I had dinner with Carter in 2015, I said, so what's your relationship like with President Obama? And he said, I have none, he snapped, you know, because he didn't feel like Obama was appreciating his efforts enough. So he had a very good relationship with Gerald Ford, and there were moments that, you know, are a little bit distant from human rights that I probably, you know, shouldn't detail just in the interest of time, where he did a seriously important favor for George H.W. Bush before doing something that completely infuriated George H.W. Bush. But when I interviewed him at the end of his life, he ended up saying how much he respected Carter and his decency and his contributions to the country and the world. So these are complicated relationships among complicated men. Carter, just one more thing on him personally. So Carter has three sons and a daughter. And his youngest son, Jeff Carter, one day I asked him, if you could use one word to describe your father, what would it be? And he said, intense. And that really summed it up. So this kind of genial, smiling guy you'd see, you know, with Jay Leno, because he got to be very good at going on these talk shows and, you know, an amusing patter. That is a little bit at odds with who he is, but I developed enormous respect and admiration for him, even though I was critical in some places. I most liked Rosalind Carter's reaction to my book. I thought she got it exactly right. And she's a tremendously formidable woman, one of the great first ladies in American history, the most influential on her husband, first lady in American history, which we could talk about, number of policy achievements. It filtered back to me that she said something like, well, Jonathan had some very critical things to say about Jimmy, but he only said nice things about me. Which is true.
Okay. Very good. One more thing that sort of segues into the political human rights issue. You do mention explicitly that Jimmy Carter has had no ideology. And I recall that when I voted for him, I did so in a way that was very tepid. I'm a man of the left, and I was not charmed by or attracted to Jimmy Carter, in part because there seemed to be no articulated ideology, left, right, or center, although he ends up in the center, I think, that one could surmise.
Well, this hurt him a lot politically because he was very hard to pigeonhole, and he was, you know, depending on the issue, he could be quite liberal on something like the environment. And then on something like government spending, he could be more conservative, although not by today's standards, not really very conservative at all. But he would bristle at being pigeonholed as a person of the left or something like that. That was just very contrary to the way he assessed issues. He thought that issues should be thought through on their merits, not through some ideological prism. But at the end of the day, he did have an ideology of peace and ethics and human rights. I mean, when he left office, Walter Mondale, as vice president, toasted him and said, you know, we kept the peace, we told the truth, and we obeyed the law. Now, that sounds like a kind of a low bar, but when you think about what's happened since, and Carter then later, when I discussed it with him, he said, and I'd add, we championed human rights. And I guess that's what we're going to talk about tonight.
That's right. Yeah. What we were talking about primarily. It seems to me, as a student of human rights, that Jimmy Carter was the person most responsible for creating the human rights culture. Before he came to office in 1977, I think few people had ever heard the term human rights. And then he declared that it would be the centerpiece of American foreign policy, and I suspect Americans didn't know what he was talking about, right? But today, human rights is everywhere. It's part of the global discourse. It's part of diplomacy. You can't engage in international relations without discussing the human rights factor. And as I mentioned to you before, I think that since the collapse of the Cold War and the relative demise of socialism, human rights really does the heavy lifting with regard to social justice. If people feel oppressed anywhere, they will make their claims for justice in the name of human rights, that their human rights are being deprived. And I think Jimmy Carter did more than anyone, not the only one, but more than anyone, to put that on the map. And I'm wondering what your assessment is generally, of most broadly, of Jimmy Carter's contribution and the legacy of his human rights commitments.
Well, I think it's an immense legacy, and it's one of the reasons why I wrote the book. In 2015, I'm in a book group here, and somebody had worked on his grandson Jason's campaign for governor of Georgia in 2014, and we read Lawrence Wright's book about Camp David, and they invited Carter and his grandson to our book group, and we spent the evening with him. You know, you could see how intelligent he was. I had only interviewed him as a Newsweek columnist once in 2000 about the Middle East. I didn't really know him. But I was hugely impressed, not just by what he said about Camp David, but when we started talking about Latin America, basically, and Carter led to many democracies in many different parts of the world. There are twice as many now as when he was president. But at the time he was president, every Latin American country, South American country, with the exception of Venezuela, was authoritarian. And of course now, it's the other way around, right? And that's not all attributable to Jimmy Carter, but the achievements are really very considerable, even though the policy was hypocritical in many ways, because during the Cold War, he had to worry about these big power Cold War questions. And so, for instance, he was urged to stand up for human rights in the Philippines, where Ferdinand Marcos was a dictator. And because a communist takeover in the Philippines would have been so threatening to U.S. national interests and actually set back the human rights campaign if they had taken over there, even though he detested Marcos, and every time Imelda Marcos, she's the one who had all the shoes, you know, when they'd come to the United States, he would make Mondale, and I saw him once joke with Mondale about this, handle them. He nonetheless couldn't stand up for human rights in the Philippines. And there are other examples of this. Just because the policy was sometimes ambivalent in the second half of his administration after the invasion of Afghanistan, the Russian Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, he had to scale it back. Just because it wasn't fully applied didn't mean that he didn't completely change the conversation and the global vocabulary. So before that, you had Eleanor Roosevelt and the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but it really wasn't part of the conversation. And then in the mid-70s, Senator Tom Harkin, Congressman Don Fraser, there were some people who were starting to talk about it, but it wasn't until Carter became president, created an Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights, and began to judge other countries in part by how they treated their own people. This had never been done before. It was just not considered to be something that U.S. foreign policy should take into account. Our national interest was not affected by the way countries treated their own people. Now, we would stand up for democratic values around the world, and Franklin Roosevelt and a lot of other presidents did that, but we wouldn't penalize countries that were abusing human rights. And that started with Carter. And so to me, this is a huge underappreciated legacy. And just very quickly, there's there was a famous Harvard professor who in 1981, the year Carter left office, was down at Emory where Carter was starting to teach. And Carter was depressed. He had just been crushed by Reagan. He hadn't started the Carter Center yet. He was at the Nader. And he sees this very distinguished professor, and the professor says to him, 1,000 years from now, there will only be a tiny handful of American presidents who will be remembered by history. And you're going to be one of them because of human rights.
Yeah. Well, I won't be here, but let's hope that that's the case. The let me just say, just to put this into context, Carter's presidency takes place during the Cold War. Containment of Soviet expansion and influence around the world is the primary driver of American foreign policy. That commits us to a policy of realpolitik. And in many cases, I don't think it's an exaggeration, it sounds simplistic, but it's true, that the United States would support any regime, no matter how authoritarian, despotic it may be, as long as it was anti-communist. And what you're saying is that Carter, through the injection of the human rights principle and factor into foreign policy, changed that conversation. However, in his inaugural, he claimed commitment to human rights will be, quote, absolute.
Yeah.
Now, anyone knows that's not possible.
Not possible.
Just simply not possible. You cannot, you have to, especially if you're committed to the preservation and security of the of your constituents, you have to engage in practical, you know, reality-based policy, which means you're going to have to compromise your human rights principles for the sake of security and strategic interests. That, in effect, led many to feel that Carter's policy, as you intimated, Jonathan, was inconsistent. Some people thought he was naive. Other people thought that, in effect, it made America weaker. Okay, he would argue that it was an exercise in American soft power that actually made us stronger. And I'm wondering if you can, that's to my mind is the nitty gritty of the conflict of human rights in the real world that he confronted, we all confront. What is your sense of that and how he worked?
Well, I mean, I think he made the United States stronger by doing this, by aligning our values with our foreign policy, our stated values. And even if he didn't do it consistently, he did it enough that it changed the emphasis, and in combination with him, so his, you know, his policy toward the Soviet Union, without getting into the Afghanistan story, was actually very important in the end of the Cold War. If you talk to people like Vaclav Havel, so what Havel, who was in prison at the time Carter was president, and like many human dissidents in prison in different countries, some in authoritarian regimes like South Korea, others in communist regimes, they all took comfort from Carter's human rights policy. He started out his presidency, on his first day, he wrote a letter to Andrei Sakharov, the Soviet dissident, which was, you know, highly publicized. So he was standing up for them right away, and what Havel later said is that this hurt the self-confidence of the communist regimes, because it started to hollow them out. Their legitimacy was suffering under the impetus of what Harvard professor Joe Nye and others have called soft power. And soft power takes many forms. It's very, very important in ending communism. And, you know, I think a lot of people know that cultural power was important. So it was under Carter that the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band was the first Western rock band to be allowed to perform in the Soviet Union. And, you know, this kind of thing, I interviewed Paul McCartney once because the Yeltsin and Gorbachev and all these, Soviet leaders were saying that the Beatles and things like that helped end communism because they showed people in these countries that there was a better life than living in these totalitarian societies and, you know, where the government told you what kind of music you could listen to, you know. And so all of this worked in combination to create an extremely effective foreign policy. And so the, and it would reinforce each other. Now, I'm not talking about Iran, which is a whole other thing. That's probably the best known and least successful part of Jimmy Carter's foreign policy, but in some cases, not through any fault of his. But if you look at something like the Panama Canal treaties, so we turned over control of the canal, which major artery of global commerce. And if Carter hadn't done that and won a almost impossible vote in the Senate, he had to get two-thirds approval for treaties that two-thirds of the country was against. But if that hadn't been accomplished and we'd had an open-ended guerrilla war in Central America, it would probably still be going on. The human rights that he was championing in Central and South America, it wouldn't have worked because they would have still despised the United States. But just to give you a little example of a story that really touched me. At one point, there was a prisoner exchange, and there was a Russian religious figure who had been imprisoned in the Soviet Union and for trying to spread Christianity, I think. And he had been in prison for some time, and he got out in a prisoner swap, and the Carters had him to church in Plains. And when they were in church, this guy whose name was Georgi Vins turned up the sole of his shoe and he pulled off the heel and he showed Rosalind Carter what he had in the heel of his shoe. And it was a little picture of Jimmy Carter. And so that kind of thing was going on all over the world. So Kim Dae-jung, who I think some of you have heard of, who was a famous dissident in South Korea, who, when he became president of South Korea in the 90s, he told Carter that, you know, he wouldn't have been alive if it hadn't been for his efforts. So these are big, you know, developments for human rights. And I think that in Carter's mind, this commitment grew out of his experience in the Jim Crow South. And what he wanted to do was globalize the civil rights movement that he had not actually himself been a part of. I think he was successful in doing so with the help of people like Andrew Young, who was his UN ambassador.
Andrew Young to the UN, yeah. Because Andrew Young was a civil rights figure who Martin right. King. And Jimmy Carter never met Martin Luther King, did he? He knew his father, but he'd never met MLK.
Himself. Right, and because it was dangerous politically for him. He was representing a Southwest Georgia, very, very conservative district in the Georgia State Senate. But he later became very, very close to Daddy King and other members of the King family. And actually, in 2019, I think, the children of Martin Luther King were squabbling over what to do with his, some of his possessions that still had not been resolved, like whether they should be in the museum or be sold and make some money. And they ended up bringing Carter in to mediate, and yeah, he settled it.
Now, let me talk about the Soviet Union and inspiring dissidents again. The Soviet Union collapsed for probably a good number of reasons, but one was internal dissent in the name of human rights. And I think those dissenters, some who came to the United States and spoke here at the New York Ethical Society, were amazingly courageous people. I mean, the Soviets didn't play footsie with their dissidents. They were very, very courageous. And I think that Carter was able to inspire those individuals, and that internal protest within the Soviet Union, which was a lockstep authoritarian, totalitarian state, really was one factor that eventually led to the collapse of the Soviet Union. And it's Carter's work by supporting
that. Yeah, I mean, I think it was actually, to be fair, it was every post-war American president contributed to containing and eventually undermining the legitimacy of the Soviet state. Yes, it was definitely a factor, and there's a guy named Lawrence Eagleburger who became Secretary of State briefly under Reagan or Bush, and he was ambassador to Yugoslavia when Carter was president. He was a foreign service officer, and he used to get really upset when a woman named Patricia Darian, who was the first assistant secretary for human rights, and she's the one who really carried out the policy, and a tremendous, fascinating woman who somebody should write her biography someday. And she ended up at the end of the administration, she was disappointed that Carter hadn't moved more aggressively on human rights, but she would go into a country, and in the case of Yugoslavia, she would denounce. At that time, it was a guy named Tito who was the head of Yugoslavia, and she would denounce his human rights abuses. And Eagleburger was the ambassador, and he's trying to get along with Tito, and like, what is this woman doing here? And she's undermining my efforts. And he was really bitterly opposed to what this democratic president was doing. In later years, he said, you know what? Carter and Patricia Darian were right. Mm-hmm. They were right. This was the way to deal with the Soviet Union and its client states in Eastern Europe.
Yep. This is your interview, but I can't resist just telling a personal anecdote. In the 1970s, during the Carter administration, I was the chairman of a small Amnesty International adoption group in Teaneck, New Jersey, and it was our charge to try to win the freedom of prisoners of conscience, and we would get a sheet from the international office in London with all the details about the prisoner that they could accumulate, and it was our job to do whatever we could to win the freedom of somebody in a faraway dungeon. And at one point, we're working on a case of a Guatemalan prisoner of conscience in some dungeon in Guatemala, and we needed more information. And my strategy I came up with is I called the U.S. State Department, and every country has its own desk officer in the State Department. And at that time, the operator answers the phone, and I said, I'm Joe Chuman. I'm the chairman of Amnesty International Group 111 in Teaneck, New Jersey. We're working on the case of a Guatemalan prisoner. Can I speak to the desk officer? And I did. And I spoke to the desk officer and told him the information that we would be helpful for us if he could provide it, dig it up, in order for us to pursue our working on this case. 2 weeks later, the phone rings in my office. I pick it up, and the guy at the other end says, Mr. Chuman, State Department calling, and he gave me the information that I was looking for. I was amazed. The U.S. State Department became an arm of my Amnesty International chapter. You know, this was during the Carter administration, and it seemed to me, just although it's episodic and anecdotal, it seemed to me that Carter, it's a little index, that Carter really did take human rights very seriously, and his State Department took it seriously. And I should say that when Ronald Reagan became president, I attempted the same strategy, and they never called me back. So there you go.
But, one of the things that surprised me in doing the book is that, yes, like when Alexander Haig became Reagan's first Secretary of State, he said, well, human rights is not going to take a back seat to, big power, anti-communism. And yet, They actually did maintain their human rights office. They continued to write reports on human rights. And the next generation of conservative intellectuals who were very big in George W. Bush's administration, you remember his second inaugural in 2005 is all about democracy and human rights. And so this eventually became part of a lot of people's worldviews. Then there would be steps back as well, particularly in Central America, and you'd go back to some pretty bad things in the Reagan administration, and then, you know, in the Trump administration, they didn't care at all about human rights. But there would be these, you know, episodic resurgences of concern about human rights in both parties.
I do want to talk about some of the negatives, though, and you do discuss them in your book. Again, critics would say that Carter's human rights policy was mixed, that he was certainly stronger on individual cases, but as you point out, there are those critics who say he didn't develop a systematic sort of policy of human rights that could be generically applied, understandably so. I mean, each situation is different. However, there are two cases I want to bring to your attention for comment that are still disturbing to me. One was El Salvador. El Salvador had one of the most ruthless, brutal dictatorships. We were throwing arms and money at them like there was no tomorrow. They were absolutely these were a system of juntas and generals, so each worse than the next. And Carter supported the Salvadoran regime in the face of what were rebel groups, some communist, some not communist, in the Salvadoran civil war. I'm not sure he couldn't have done more in that regard. The second case I want to bring up to you is even starker in my mind, and that had to do with Cambodia, and where realpolitik and strategy really trumps human rights in that regard. The Carter administration, it was not the only one, recognized and supported the Khmer Rouge's placement at the United Nations to represent Cambodia, okay? In great measure to curry favor with the Chinese, okay, and to ensure that the Soviets who supported the Vietnamese, who actually intervened to overthrow that genocide, okay, was not in effect curried or allied with. The genocide in Cambodia was the worst genocide since the Holocaust, and it was well documented, it was awful, and supporting the Khmer Rouge for any reason seems to me to be run against a correct human rights policy, in my view.
I totally agree.
Those seem to me to be the biggest contradictions, if not violations.
I totally agree, and I think Carter, was tormented by this. Just briefly on El Salvador, so right-wingers assassinated the Archbishop Romero, and then the very end of the Carter administration, the right wing killed some nuns. I mean, it was bad stuff, but he was whipsawed by a variety of political pressures that suggested that if we let the communists have a foothold in Central America, and the rebels in El Salvador, they were communists, right? There were, but they were. It was a legitimate danger. It was so. Do I wish he had been a little less supportive of the right wing there? Of course, but you when you're president, you do have to kind of weigh these things. Something similar happened in El Salvador, in Nicaragua, and there there's a quite big achievement after Carter leaves the presidency, where he talks, that's very relevant for Trump and the transition of power. He talks Daniel Ortega into very reluctantly leaving power after he lost an election. It was the first time a communist leader anywhere in the world had done that, and they'd had the peaceful transfer of power. And it was Carter saying, I lost, and it's tough to lose, but,
it's unfortunately so, Daniel has come back again.
He's come back. So in Central America, it's a very mixed record. Situation in Cambodia, so 1.7 million Cambodians died in the late 1970s, were killed by the Khmer Rouge, and I'm sure some of you have seen the killing fields. But the geopolitics of this were, and Carter, as this was going on and the stories were coming out, Carter was critical of the Khmer Rouge as president. But I said, were you critical enough? And we had a slightly, it wasn't contentious, but I was very determined to press him on this. And I finally got him to say, and I quote in the book, you know, no, I did not denounce the Khmer Rouge enough when I was president. Then the Vietnamese, who had just beaten us in a war that ended in 1975, they drove the Khmer Rouge out of power, and they didn't replace them with nice guys. They turned Cambodia into a communist client state of Vietnam. So at this time, China and Vietnam were at odds, and China was run by Deng Xiaoping. And Deng Xiaoping, in 1979, when he came to the United States, and he and Carter normalized relations with China, which, slight details, the foundation of today's global economy. Then he went back to China the next week and legalized private property. At that time, they had a GDP that of a sub-Saharan African country, and we know what they're like now. So none of that would have been possible without normalization. When he's in Washington, he tells Carter, hey, I'm going to invade Vietnam and teach them a lesson. And Carter's like, you know, we can't stop you from doing it, but we don't really want this to, you know, upset this detente that we now have, which is very much in our mutual interest. So Carter, when the question came of whether to seat the Vietnamese puppets in the UN or the exiled Khmer Rouge remnants, the United States was in a very difficult position because all of our allies who were on the side of against Vietnamese imperialism at that point. And so we would have been siding with basically the communist regimes and our only recent former enemy. So I'm not rationalizing that they did this, but I was convinced, and also after reading Cy Vance's, he was the Secretary of State, his sort of tortured portion of his memoirs on this, they were in a kind of a squeeze. Now, I think where I would be critical of them is that you have to ask yourself, what's the worst case? If they had sided, if they had pissed off China by siding with the Vietnamese, would Deng Xiaoping have, like, you know, ended normalization? No, it was a important foreign policy issue for Deng Xiaoping, but not as important as his relationship with the United States. So I think that Carter definitely could have gone the other way on that. And from his tone and body language, when I was interviewing him about it, I think he regretted that decision, but was not willing to say so.
I could talk all night about this. I think there's so many details, and they're so interesting, and it's important to clarify these things for the record and so forth. Three cases I want to bring up. The first one is Camp David, and of course that there's a sort of line between Camp David and events of the current moment. Your book elaborates a great deal the complexity of the Camp David Accords. I mean, the simple takeaway is that there was a peace treaty between Egypt and Israel, and it's now an open border, and the Sinai is now demilitarized, and Carter helped enable almost half the Arab world to be at peace, a cold peace, but at peace with Israel. That's a major achievement. But it was not brought to conclusion at Camp David. There was an aftermath, and it was sort of edgy and difficult, and he was very troubled. And I was wondering if you can talk a little bit about what the process was truly about.
Well, first, you know, just the overviews in the years since, because Carter is easily the most pro-Palestinian president we've ever had in this country, there's been this sense that, no, he's not good for Israel. And he negotiated twice with Hamas, as a matter of fact, in 2006 and 2008. 2006, he was trying to get Hamas on the same page as the Palestinian Authority. And that was a little naive. I think we can tell, given the events of recent weeks, that wasn't going to happen. But his motive was a good one, because there couldn't be a two-state solution if Hamas and the PA were fighting, which is what Bibi's policy was, to bolster Hamas. There's been a lot about this in the Israeli press in the last few weeks, that Bibi has propped up Hamas for years in order to not have to negotiate with a single negotiating partner. So that was one negotiation with Hamas. The second was to try to get a prisoner out, and the Israelis were happy that he was at least trying to do that. But at Camp David, you know, what I say frequently when I talk about Carter, I will have questioners say, well, he's bad on Israel. And it's true that he got very, he felt his biggest regret about not getting reelected was that Camp David was supposed to start a process that would lead to a two-state solution. And it did start that process in Oslo, and the entire peace process, as it was called, came out of Camp David. But there was a timetable for it to happen that he thought had been agreed upon at Camp David, and Menachem Begin didn't see it the same way. And Carter thinks that if he'd been reelected, he actually could have brought a regional peace that would be, you know, much more like Northern Ireland now. Like the fighting would be over. And so this torments him. And I'm sure that even though he's 99 and not talking to people right now, he still has his marbles. And I'm sure that this is really upsetting him now, that because he feels this very strongly. And the Holy Land, as he calls it, is for his own personal religious reasons, and he became obsessed by it. But what I think his critics don't understand is that Jimmy Carter was the greatest president for the security of the state of Israel since Harry Truman recognized Israel in 1948. And that's because there was only one army with the military capacity to destroy Israel. Hamas, they ain't destroying Israel. They might have dopey students chanting from the river to the sea, you know, the implication being that no Israel. But they're not going to get that, right? That's not going to happen. The Egyptian army, however, which fought Israel in 1948, 56, 67, and 73, they truly could have driven Israel into the sea if they had been more successful. And they were likely to try again. And so this peace treaty, which is the most durable since World War II, is a huge frickin' deal, and not well enough understood the level of accomplishment, not just for Israel, but in terms of preventing, you know, what we're now worried about, which is regional war. So the fact that, I mean, I don't think we're talking about Egypt enough right now in this whole conversation, because, you know, they've been part of making Gaza what they call an open air prison. You know, Egypt has a lot of responsibility for that, because their border is closed. They don't want Palestinians in Egypt. And they've been cutting off support for Gaza as well. You almost never hear that in the last couple of weeks. But the fact remains that nobody's talking about them engaging in a regional war. There's a lot of talk about Iran and, you know, what Hezbollah and Lebanon get in, whatever. But imagine if the major power in the Middle East, Egypt, was in the conversation now. It's not, and that's because of Jimmy Carter.
No, I think that's really a tremendous achievement in that regard. And most people don't realize, with a population of almost 100 million, Egypt is almost half the Arab world. That's at peace with it's a cold peace, but at peace with, yeah. with Israel, and it's an open border. You can travel. It's demilitarized. You can travel. My wife took a bus from Cairo to Tel Aviv and do that, right? So anyway, that's
a little harder to do that right now.
It's harder, though. And I don't think anybody would right want now. To. Yes, you know, tourism has certainly declined under current circumstances. Yeah. But that's the first thing I want to talk to you about. The big one, of course, that looms today is Iran. And one could argue that the greatest factor in doing Jimmy Carter's reelection in was the hostage crisis that lasted in more than a year. It was agonizing. People remember Nightline with Ted Koppel? Every night, you know, he'd say, you know, this is the 376th day of the hostages.
That and was you actually have, Walter Cronkite who said was, that.
Did he start that?
He would end his broadcast saying this is the...
Oh, okay, but didn't Koppel...
Koppel, that show up? Started...
Started, yes.
...as America held hostage, and then it became Nightline. So he didn't use that tagline, but right. It was the same thing.
Anyway, you have an anecdote in there that when Jimmy Carter met Ted Koppel, he said, you're basically two people profited from the hostage crisis, the Ayatollah Khomeini and you. Right?
Yeah.
As a result of that, he obviously resented the constant, you know, repetition of this issue, which did not serve him well.
And he brought that on himself because he let himself get taken hostage by the Ayatollah. And so that was, I mean, the press obviously didn't help, but Carter, you know, conveyed that he was thinking about it all the time. He stopped traveling on the campaign, and he, eventually succeeded. He got all the hostages out safely. Imagine if that happened now in Gaza. That wasn't until just moments
there was
before.
A lot of work behind the scenes.
Moments after he left office.
Clear that there was an attempt behind the scenes at negotiations and so forth.
Oh, many attempts. There were, the hostage rescue mission that failed, and the helicopters crashed in the desert. And I'm not sure that he would have been reelected if not for that, because we had double-digit inflation and double-digit interest rates. I mean, people think inflation's high now. It's low compared to what it was under Carter.
The malaise speech.
Yeah, well, he didn't use the word malaise, but, But, you know, the 70s were a very bitter time in this country, and in some ways, the current period is reminiscent of certain parts of the 70s.
You know, Amnesty International, it was very active at that time, gave a lot of press to the brutality of the Shah and the Iranian regime, dissidents being imprisoned in Evin prison. The use of torture got a lot of exposure. And it seems to me that Carter sort of allied himself with the Shah maybe longer than he should have. What was his relationship? It was complex and it changed. But what was the relationship that Carter had with the Shah of Iran?
So, they didn't, you know, they certainly didn't have anywhere near the relationship that Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger, who were like, they vacationed with the Shah. He was their genuine buddy. And Carter had a kind of a chilly relationship with him. So his biggest mistake was that on New Year's Eve, in his first year, New Year's Eve, between 77 and 78, he was in Tehran and he toasted the Shah as an island of stability in the Middle East. And that's actually what he thought of when he thought about Iran, that it was it borders the Soviet Union, what was then the Soviet Union. And so it was accepted by everybody in the foreign policy, national security establishment, that it was a buffer against the Soviet Union, you know, for decades during the Cold War. So, but he was troubled by the Shah's human rights abuses. And when the Shah came to Washington and was welcomed on the South Lawn, there were these very intense protests, and there was fighting that broke out between the anti-Shah protesters, who were a lot of them were students at American universities. And in retrospect, you know, these people were supporting the Ayatollah Khomeini. I mean, he was a lot worse than the Shah, right? They were battling with the Shah's secret police who were there, the Savak, they were called. And to break up the demonstrations, the American authorities used tear gas. And the tear gas floated up onto the South Lawn and was really intense. I quote what Carter says in his diary about the tear gas. I mean, everybody there was gassed, and they had to like put their coats over their faces on the South Lawn of the White House, right? And then, and it interrupted this event. And then they go inside, and Carter has this meeting with the Shah, and he puts it to him. He said, "Look, this is partly as a result of your human rights abuses. You need to do better on this. You need to respect people's human rights." So he told him this privately, but he wasn't in a situation where he could cut off support for him. Not that we, you know, we were still selling them weapons and stuff. And when I interviewed Kissinger, who to this day has this bogus claim that if Jimmy Carter had only supported the Shah more, the Iranian Revolution, biggest revolution of the 20th century since the Russian Revolution, with enormous impact in everything about today's world, was affected by this revolution. But the idea that Carter could have stopped it if he had supported the Shah more, I think, doesn't hold water. I also don't think that, I think he was unrealistic in thinking that the Shah could be replaced by a democratic regime. That was a lack of understanding about what was going on in Iranian politics at the time.
Underestimates and undervalues how much the outlying mullahs and religious classes and the poor were anti-Shah. I mean, the Shah had really alienated.
Oh, yeah.
That was right.
Yeah.
And the Ayatollah was able to sort of maximize their anger and upset with the Shah to create the revolution.
I mean, there's just great backstories to all of this and the student takeover of the U.S. Embassy, all of which I deal with in my book at some length.
Okay, the last, there's so many things we could talk about, so many details and instances internationally, all of which are so interesting. The last one I want to talk about is Afghanistan, which of course brings us in some ways up to the moment too. The United States, and I guess Brzezinski was a big enabler of this, armed the freedom fighters. As I recall, this was towards the end of the Carter regime, right? The Mujahideen,
right,
to fight against the Soviets. The Soviets had come in and so forth. It was their Vietnam, right? They were eventually repulsed. But I'm wondering whether that was a mistake. I mean, in some ways, by arming, this was still containment of Soviet, obviously, still the Cold War, the last phases and containment, whether it was good policy, you know, with 2020 hindsight, to be arming these so-called freedom fighters with lots of weapons, including these Stinger missiles and so on, that they seem to turn on Americans after.
Well, eventually, I mean, if you look at the,
they did. So
if you look at the blowback, so when I interviewed Brzezinski not long before he died,
what?
I interviewed Zbigniew Brzezinski not long before he died, and he was the one who revealed to a French newspaper much later that we had started arming the Mujahideen in the summer of 1979. And this, you know, I said, well, you know, Osama bin Laden, that was how he first showed his stuff. And, you know, the Mujahideen, they became the Taliban. And this really, and his answer was, look, if I had to choose between winning the Cold War and whatever the blowback was with the Taliban, I'd take winning the Cold War. Because his argument was that by turning or beginning the process, which Reagan built on, of turning Afghanistan into the Soviet Vietnam, that was extremely important in ending communism. And it's kind of a, you know, fascinating, unanswerable historical question. If you look at, I got very interested in what the Soviet archives were showing about why Brezhnev invaded Afghanistan. And it turned out that, so the U.S. ambassador had been murdered. You know, imagine today if a U.S. ambassador in that part of the world was murdered, it would be a huge deal. It was just like another one of the many crazy things that were happening in this period. And his replacement, had a relationship with, developed a relationship with the new leader of Afghanistan, who had smothered his rival to death with pillows, had his agents do this, and had taken over, and he was secretly playing footsie with the United States. And the Russians found out about this, and they were worried. They thought that Afghanistan was their client state, and that this, the leaders were their puppets. But when they found out that actually the new leader was hanging out with the new U.S. ambassador, that's when the Politburo decided to invade. And so in some ways, you know, I think the better critique of U.S. foreign policy in that period would be Ted Kennedy's critique, which is that we overreacted to the Soviet invasion. Carter basically changed everything about U.S. foreign policy after that happened. And he, you know, human rights was de-emphasized, and it was like a return of the Cold War because the Russians had done this, and things got pretty tense in 1980. So I think Kennedy, in retrospect, may have been right that, you know, there was a lot of silly talk about how this gave the Soviets access to the Persian Gulf, when actually it didn't, because Afghanistan's not on the Persian Gulf. It was not strategically very important, and our national security establishment pretended that it was in that period, and that was, I think that was a pretty big mistake by Carter.
I want to end on a positive note, and then we'll open up to some questions. We have some time for anyone who does have some queries of Jonathan Alter. You know, I, as I've said, I've worked and taught in the human rights field for a long time, and it seems to me, again, that Carter really was instrumental in creating the human rights culture. I think we have to appreciate that there are over 10,000 non-governmental organizations around the world that work on human rights of various types. Some are large, like Amnesty International, with 3 million people. Some are very small, some are very good, some not so good, some are religious, some are secular. But it's really a grassroots movement of tremendous exposure, and Carter helped to bring that about, I think. Amnesty International won the Nobel Peace Prize at one point, not long after. Also a few other accomplishments. He signed the Refugee Act into law. I mean, the irony is that Ted Kennedy, who didn't like him very much, actually propelled that, I think, through the Senate, and Carter signed the Refugee Act that basically made federal law out of the International Refugee Convention of...
Yeah, they rescued a lot of boat people.
In 1951. Yeah. That was an important achievement, and as you mentioned, he founded the Subdepartment on Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs, which is still around, and was really a great, you know, did a lot of other things to support the world of human rights. You know, I'm wondering whether, you know, we're entering a dark period in world and American history where authoritarianism and demagoguery grassroots sort of negative political ideologies are taking hold. And the question I often have is whether human rights can survive this dark period, whether there's enough momentum looking forward in the human rights world to keep it on the forefront of, it's instantiated into an international law, that's true, whether in effect there's enough momentum that human rights can survive and help repel the darkness that's falling over the globe.
Well, that's why the 2024 election is so important. It's democracy versus authoritarianism, straight up. It's binary choice. And if we go authoritarian, which if you listen to Trump, he will turn us into an authoritarian state. There's not any doubt about this. It's, you know, when these guys say things, the first rule is you have to believe them. And when he says, you know, where I'm going to suspend the Constitution, I'm going to, you know, use retribution as my defining policy, it's curtains. for democracy, I believe. I don't think it's an exaggeration. And obviously that would do, you know, mortal damage to the success of democracy globally. Now, could we ultimately survive it, because things are ultimately cyclical? Perhaps, but it would deal a huge blow. But having said that, there are more democracies in the world now, twice as many as there were in the 1970s. So democracy is not dead yet. And I think there are, you know, there have been some setbacks for the authoritarians. Bolsonaro is out of power in Brazil. You know, Duterte is out of power in the Philippines.
Poland just pushed back at an election.
There are a number. So it's an ongoing struggle, and people have to be in the struggle, I think, and they have to be smart about what, you know, what regimes really are authoritarian dangers, and, you know, which ones are not. And but being, you know, I get very concerned when I see the Republican Party paying so much homage to Orban in Hungary. It's like they're patterning themselves on Orban. And it is, you know, I think it is, you know, the issue that you raised, Joe, it's a little bit like climate change. It is the one of the three or four major issues facing humanity in the 21st century. Which direction do we go? And really bad things that we could talk about all night happen if there are too many setbacks and we have strong men running major countries around the world.
And on the note that it's a good time to remember Jimmy Carter's commitments to human rights and put them in the forefront of our concern.
I hope that Carter's life, it can be an inspiration to people and a motivation to go out and work for peace and human rights, which are sometimes at odds with each other. I mean, Carter spent a lot of time with dictators because his view as a former president was you got to get the bullets to stop flying first. And so they're fascinating disputes that he had in recent years with members of the human rights community about how do you order priorities, and that sometimes peace and human rights are complementary and sometimes they're at odds because you have to deal with some pretty shady characters to get to peace.
Right. True enough. Well, reality in life is complex.
It's complicated.
Okay, let's extend a very warm expression of gratitude to Jonathan Alter. Yeah, thank you. It's been absolutely, absolutely fascinating, detailed information, rich.
Got a little down in the weeds there.
Yeah, but right. No, down in the weeds. Okay, we have time for some questions if people would like to. Yes? Do you have a mic for, or do you want to use one?
So, Betsy was a very distinguished network news correspondent in the 70s and 80s who covered Jimmy Carter.
Occasionally. What did he talk about his relationship with Arafat? And what did he say about the negotiation, push Arafat not to agree?
Not to agree in 2000, you mean? When Clinton did the deal and then Arafat... So it's funny that you mentioned that because before my book, which I started in 2015, the only time I'd interviewed Jimmy Carter was on a Habitat for Humanity site in the Bronx in 2000, right after Clinton negotiated this deal, which Arafat sabotaged. And I was writing a column in Newsweek at that time, and I went and saw Carter, and I said, did you urge Arafat, who I knew he had become friendly with, to agree with Clinton and do this deal, which would have given 92% of what the Palestinians wanted? It was a really good deal, and Bill Clinton, who I interviewed a couple years later extensively about this. I did the first interview with him after he left the presidency, and a lot of it was about this failure, which he was very, very angry at Arafat for not agreeing to. And when I asked Carter about it, he said simply, well, Arafat would have been killed if he had signed this deal. And at the time, and then later when I interviewed him about it more, I thought, you know, really? Like, couldn't you have just urged him to do it, pushed him a little harder on this? And Carter was, well, I could have, but he was signing his own death warrant. And I thought at the time, that's pretty harsh. But now, given what just happened, I think Carter was right. That Hamas, they would have just, their agents would have just killed Arafat if he signed the deal. So ultimately, he didn't have the courage to do it. I was uncomfortable with how friendly Carter got with Arafat. He had him down to planes. Arafat is like, you live in this house? You were president? You live in this $60,000 house? You know? And you could make a good case that Carter should have leveraged his relationship with Arafat and not agreed with him when he said, I'll be killed if I do this, and just pressed him and said, you know, you can get good enough physical protection and be seen as a great man in history if you do this. And I don't think Carter actually did that. And when I questioned him about it, he was vague. I don't think ultimately Arafat was, who had been a terrorist, was a he was no Anwar Sadat. Let's put it that way. Yeah, and ultimately he came to Washington, went to the Clinton White House, and shook hands with Rabin. But ultimately, I think he was once a terrorist, always a terrorist. And he had a lot of blood on his hands. Yasser Arafat did.
Any other questions? Yes, no. Big opportunity. Yes, anyone else? Okay, I hope people found the evening inspiring, engaging, fulfilling, informational, educational. Okay. Hope you leave
thank
knowing
you
more than when you came in.
Thanks.
Jonathan Alter, thank you so very much again. Yeah, thank you.